Praise the Lord. Good morning, Montgomery Baptist Church. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Pleasure to be here in the house of the Lord this morning in the middle of May on a sunny Sunday where we know God is still in the business of blessing folks. Thank you for joining us. We're happy to see you here in the flesh. We're happy to have you all joining us that are joining us online. It is so exciting to be here and to prepare our hearts and our minds to praise the Lord and to hear a word from the Lord this morning, again delivered through our pastor as he continues on through the book of Ephesians. It's been great. If you haven't seen the last few sermons, they are available on Facebook, on our website. Please do join and go take a look at those, and thank you for joining again this morning. As is our custom, we are here and everyone is masked up. Except for me, but we may have further announcements about that soon. But before we do, let me start off with a word as I read Psalm number 40, verses 1, 2, and 3 to open us up. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me, and he heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. Let us pray. Father God, this is the day that you have made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you, Father God, for blessing, keeping, protecting, and guiding. We thank you for helping us to make it through the last week that we just finished, whether it was challenging or whatever it was, Father God. We know that you were with us throughout it all. We know, Father God, that it is you who are preparing our minds and our hearts and are girding our feet, Father God, for the week that is ahead. And so we thank you in advance. We thank you for those that are here. We thank you for those that are on their way. We thank you for those that are joining us online, Father God, and ask that each one, Father God, will prepare their hearts to receive a word from you delivered through our pastor this morning that would uplift, convict, and do all things to draw us closer unto you, Father God. These and all blessings we ask in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus. Let all God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. It is just, again, a blessing to be here. Many of you have heard that the CDC made an announcement this week that they, last week, I think, they said that the lifting of masks was okay outside. This week, they announced that the lifting of masks, if you were vaccinated, was okay inside. The pastor may have more announcements either today or moving forward about how we're going to treat that here at the church moving forward and what Montgomery County is planning to do and how we're going to go forward. But still trust and believe that we're going to be safe and we want you to be safe. And so I encourage everyone to get vaccinated, knowing and understanding that even while we continue to have to physically distance for a while, we are still spiritually and socially connected and will continue to be through our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. Thank you for joining us online. Amen. Please do be encouraged and join us here in person as the Lord leads.
Amen.
Know that God is awesome. God Amen. Hasn't forgotten about Amen. The struggle that you are going through. God knows that the last year has been challenging for us, but as the song that I heard in the car as we were on the way here this morning says, God has not forgotten. If he said that he will do it, it will come to pass. You can take that to the bank, as the saying goes. If he said he will do it, it will come to pass. It doesn't happen in our time. It happens in his time. But just stand by and watch God work and see how amazing God is. Can he grow you spiritually? Can he grow you materially? Can he grow you emotionally and in your relationships? Can he grow this church? Can he keep you safe? Will he keep you fed? Will he keep you spiritually, mentally, and emotionally nourished? Will he grow those relationships at work? Will he provide for a new job? Will he keep you in an old job? Will he help you to manifest your best at school? Absolutely, you can count on that. Our God is an awesome God. And all we need to do is stop for a moment and take a look around and see how good and how awesome our God is. I can't remember if I said this last week or not, but it's worth saying again as society starts to open up again and slowly but surely things are going back to normal one of the things that I haven't been able to do, and my colleagues haven't been able to do for a long time, is get back on the road and visit clients, as we oftentimes have to do. And slowly but surely that's happening, and a group of my colleagues actually about a week or two ago had to go over to a client site over in Iceland and spent about a week or 8 days with those clients, and over the intervening weekend got the chance to do some sightseeing, and I don't remember the name of the volcano, but there was a volcano in Reykjavik that was active, and I saw pictures both on email and Facebook from some of my work colleagues posing at a safe distance, socially distanced, in front of an active volcano. I mean, literally lava spewing forth in the background. And it, as I looked at that, I was like, boy, I'd love to have a picture like that. That's pretty cool from a safe distance. But it also really is, yes, a very safe distance. But it really is pictures like that to me, more than anything, remind us in very stark terms about the power of God and what it is that He has created on this earth. It doesn't take much at all for things to change, right? Some ransomware hacker allegedly in Russia jams up the Colonial Pipeline, and all of a sudden people on the East Coast are losing their minds, and flights are being canceled, and it's lines around the corner to the gas station on Thursday or Friday morning. I had to go to 6 gas stations to get gas. Just that little thing, the click of a button, just jammed us all up. Human beings can do that, but God can make volcanoes erupt. He can cause tectonic plates to shift. God, in an instant, can change things in a good way, but if He needs to, in a bad way as well. We serve an awesome God, and because we know He has that amount of power, and we claim victory through Him, and we know that His Son died for us. Just remember, whatever your circumstance and situation, whatever it is you're dealing with right now, in your home, on your job, at your school, somewhere in betwixt and in between, God is able to do all things. Just keep telling yourself He can fix your situation. What you need to do is to remain steadfast and focused on Him.
Amen.
That's why I read Psalm 40. Wait patiently for the Lord, and then stand firm, knowing He will incline to you. He will bring you up out of a pit, and He will put a new song in your mouth.
Yes.
He will put a new song in your mouth. When He puts that song in your mouth, sing it.
Yes, sir.
And let people know how God is a good God. Yes. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Bless Him this morning. As I said, our pastor is planning to continue his walk through the book of Ephesians this morning. And so if you would, please grab your hard copy of your Bible, grab your sword that you have sheathed in your phone, however it is that you are carrying your Bible these days, and turn with me to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. And we're going to lift up specifically verses 10 through 17. This will come as no surprise when you see which scripture this is. If you don't know it by heart, the title is Suit Up of Pastor's Message. We're going to look at Ephesians 6, 10 through 17. If you are here in the room, as you find that, please stand as we prepare to read God's word. If you are at home, please stand, or if you can't, be in an attitude and posture of reverence in honor of God's word. I'm going to read the New King James Version. This is Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 17, where the word of the Lord reads as follows. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all of the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Amen. Let the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of God's word. Let all God's people say, amen. 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 You may be seated. Amen. I'm sure you'll hear this from the pastor, but just in case y'all didn't know it, you are in a war, and so you need to be dressed for that fight. Pastor's words this morning for this sermon today, coming from the pastor's heart, read as follows. As we close out this series, we will talk about how we must suit up with the armor of God if we want to be all that God intends for us to be. People don't generally like to be in a physical battle. However, when it comes to a spiritual battle, more often than not, we have to engage if we want to survive and to thrive.
Yes.
The good thing is that we as believers are provided all of the equipment that we need to do so. Instead of being so concerned about what we wear physically, maybe it's time that we spend more time making sure we are dressed right spiritually. Amen. Doing this will help us to be victors instead of victims. Bless the Lord, encourage you, and encourage our pastor as he comes.
Praise the Lord, saints. I'm coming to you online in 3, 2, 1. You see me. Praise the Lord, saints, one more time.
Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and we are going to be glad. We are glad in it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I hope that you have been encouraged by our series in Ephesians. In chapter 1, let me just go back real quick. We talked about eyes wide open as we recognize the power of God in our life. In chapter 2, we talked about the importance of God's grace and mercy. Chapter 3, we focused on the reasons why we should stay humble, because of all God has done for us. Chapter 4, things we ought to do as a believer. And in chapter 5, we spoke about remembering the basics. There are certain basic things that we need to do as a child of God to survive and thrive. See, we don't just want to survive. We want to thrive in this world. Amen? And in chapter 6, after Paul talks to the children about how they can live a good long life by being obedient to their parents, he reminds us now, after all this, after all the talk about the grace and mercy of God, after all the talk about the basics and being humble, after all the talk about remembering how good God has been to us, we've got to learn, we've got to suit up. Say suit up.
Suit up.
Because if you haven't learned over the last few years and prior and in the years to come, you have been in the battle.
Amen.
You've been in the battle. And so as a child of God, we got to know how to suit up. Amen?
Amen?
Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, this is the day that you have made, and of course, we do rejoice and are glad in it. Father, we know that you do all things well and that there is no failure with God. We ask now that you will speak through your servant, speak to your servant. Might the words of my mouth, the meditations upon my heart be acceptable in your sight. Might we leave this place saying it was great for us to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Father, it's good to hear from you this morning as we continue down this journey of life. Help us to learn how to suit up and be prepared for all that the enemy throws our way. Because truly, the enemy is alive and well. So just bless the hearers, bless the speaker. And when we leave this place, help us to bear to say it was good for us to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It's good to see all of you online. Good to see all of you in person. The numbers are slowly creeping back up inside the building. We encourage you as you get vaccinated and feel comfortable. We welcome you back with open arms. We want you to continue to be a part of this church, not just online, but in person as well. Amen.
Amen.
As the deacon alluded to, it's more than likely we will hear from news from the county as it relates to like a mask wearing, probably around the 28th. It is believed that the mandate is going to be lifted at that time. And so here at the church, we will follow those guidelines. If you have been vaccinated, if you haven't been vaccinated, we want you to continue wearing your mask. And if you've been vaccinated and you feel comfortable wearing your mask, by all means, wear your mask. Nobody's going to say, take that mask off. Okay? Yeah, if you want to wear it, wear it. But you won't have to wear it if you have been vaccinated. And so we thank God that we seem to be turning that corner. Amen. But we know that there are many more corners to turn. Amen?
Amen.
And so we just thank God for you. It's been quite a year, quite a 12, 13 months. A lot of things have happened over the last year that have caused a lot of pain and sorrow. But look at you, look at me. You're still here.
Amen. Amen.
And you might have lost your mind, but you're getting it back right now by the grace of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. So, yeah, you can clap on that because I know you lost your mind. I want you to know also that as we close out this series, I will then take off a couple Sundays. I call it a Sunday sabbatical, if you will, two, maybe three. I just need a break. Appreciate preaching to you through this whole time and giving you all that God has given me Sunday after Sunday. But sometimes your pastor just needs to sit down just for a few minutes. He ain't going no place. He just needs to sit down. Amen. But you're not going to miss a beat because you're going to be hearing from my assistant, Pastor Thomas. And you've heard him before. He needs no introduction. You know, he knows how to bring forth the word of God.
Amen. Amen.
If I had his energy sometime when I see him preaching, I'd tell you. But he brings it, and he brings it home, and he brings it hard. And I appreciate that. So don't think, well, Pastor Ice is not there. No, you need not only come, but you need to bring somebody else. Yeah. Or tell somebody else to be online and take heed. Because he will be bringing forth a powerful word as he always has in the past. So I encourage you to encourage him. Pray for my family as we'll be going through North Carolina to see some family and friends. The tank is filled right now with gas. We know we can get there. If we can't get back, well, we got lots of folks in North Carolina. So we'll be okay. But it's just time for a little getaway with no doctor's appointments, no phone calls, and all that kind of good stuff. So try to take care of all that this past week. So we thank God for the opportunity we have. The car is packed. I got my overnight bag in there for me to change after service. So when you see me come out that office, you won't see this. You know, pop a suit on that I'm wearing right now. You can see this. But you know, my wife knows when I'm ready to go, we got to go.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen, Pastor T. You understand that? When it's time to go, it's time to go. So we look forward to that. Turn in your word to Ephesians chapter 6 and say, neighbor, suit up. We're going to talk about three things as you suit up. We talked about suiting up this morning. The attitude, the enemy, the equipment. The attitude, the enemy, and the equipment. Now, it starts out again in chapter 6, giving children a reminder to obey their parents in the Lord. You can't miss that point, not just saying anything to your children, but in the Lord, because it's right. And he talks about servants being obedient to their masters. And then he goes down to verse 10, and he says, finally, you know, after talking about God's grace, after talking about how we should be humble and thankful for all of his goodness towards us, after reminding us, for those who seem to forget, that we're saved by grace through faith, and that is a gift of God, not a works, as any man should boast. After all that, he says, finally. Somebody say, finally.
Finally.
When you say finally, that's like we finally are getting to the end, to the crux, to the point of the whole matter. Finally, my brothers, it's good to be able to call somebody your brother in Christ, your sister in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Finally, my brothers, be strong. Somebody say, be strong.
Be strong.
Be strong. You know, you work out to build up strength in your body physically. Amen?
Amen.
You try to eat right. You try to walk a little bit to build up some strength. We need people to be strong in the Lord. If you haven't learned anything over the last 2, 3, 4, 5 years, you need to be built up in the Lord, because there's a warfare that we're going to talk about this morning, And it's not just against the flesh, but it's against the spirits of things in this world that are evil. Yes. And you need to be strong. People are coming at you from all angles, like they've never come at you before. They're coming at me, believe me, in ways that they never came at me before. Mm. You have to be strong in the Lord.
Yeah.
Somebody say strong in the Lord.
Strong in the Lord.
And in the power of his might. So where is your strength? In the Lord. And where do you get the might? From God, his might. Not by yourself, not by spirit, but by his spirit saves the Lord. Not by might nor power, but by my spirit saves the Lord. You got to be strong in the Lord.
Yes.
See, if you rely on your own strength, your strength is going to fail you. There are times when we really think we got it all together and we got it going on, and then we just collapse. There have been times for me, and I'm sure for you, when things that have happened over the last 12 months simply drained us. And it started out with an emotional draining, a spiritual draining, and then it ended up with a physical draining. And we just didn't feel like we had any strength. You haven't been dealing with this situation, or this is a difficult situation. You don't understand. You don't understand God's time. You don't understand his purpose. And Satan, by the way, just because you're going through stuff, don't think Satan's going to give you a break. That's when he comes at you even more.
Yeah.
Remember the story about Job? If you know, God, you're only protecting Job because you know, he's only trusting you because you're good to him. And then we know the trials that Job had to go through. We know that his own wife says, you know what? I done been to church with you every Sunday, but it's about time to curse God and just let it go. Because we ain't got no hope. See, there are things that have happened in your life and my life that have severely tested your faith and your strength and made you weak. That's why we got to be strong in the Lord and in his power. You don't have any power of yourself.
Amen.
Our power has been known to fail us. My power has been known to fail me. Your power has to be from your strength in the Lord. He tells us now, as we talk about the attitude, to put on the whole armor. Somebody say whole armor.
Whole armor.
That you can withstand against the wiles, the deceitfulness, the tricks of the devil. See, understand, Satan has all of his angels, his demon angels, looking for you. See, they know that you're saved, so now they're angry with you. They're mad at you. So they can't affect your salvation, but they can certainly affect your mind. They can certainly affect your thought process. And so if you don't think the devil and his demons are real, you need to read your Bible. Go over to Acts when people try to imitate Paul and tried to cast out some demons, and they spoke to them and said, we know about Jesus, we know about Paul, but we don't know nothing about you. You're toast. Okay? And they attacked them. Believe me, I've had the spiritual pleasure, I can say it that way, of having to release people from that possession of demons. And it wasn't a pretty sight. And the noises that I would hear and talking to people weren't things that they could even describe in the movies. And we know they do their best to describe these things in the movies, but until you've experienced it and seen for yourself, it's the real deal. This is why, by the way, you got to wash what you wash what your family washes. Sometimes it starts out, this ain't so bad, but when it gets to that point, you realize, need to shut that down.
That's right.
Mama, no. We can do a lot of things. You get a lot of freedom, but that's going to be shut down.
Amen.
Because you're not trying to bring that stuff upon yourself. And you're certainly not trying to bring it to your home. For some reason, more often than not, this year, the last few months, I've had people come to me on staff and say that they feel a certain way and they don't want to carry it home. What can they do to go home in peace? And to me, the scripture is real simple. You pray up, be filled with the Spirit, and when you leave this place, shake the dust off your feet. And keep on stepping. You need to understand that you're fighting against an angry devil. and his beings. Revelation tells us he's upset because he knows his time is short. He knows that the Lord is about to come back, whether it be 1,000 years or 1,000 days, it's sooner than what it was before. He's about to come back. And so they are angry. And they know they can't keep you out of heaven, but they could sure try to make your life miserable on earth. They are deceitful. You have got to have the attitude that I'm going to put on the whole armor of God that we're going to see in just a couple of minutes so that we can stand up against the deceitfulness, the trickery of Satan. He's very deceitful. He could disguise himself in various forms. You need to be aware of who you're battling.
Yes.
We're not talking about some cartoon character who's red with a pointy tail and a pitchfork that makes you laugh. Okay. No, this guy, this real Satan, does not make you laugh. He does not make you laugh. He will try to destroy you if you're not prayed up and strong in the Lord. And if you don't put on the whole, see, you can't take the Bible and just read what makes you feel good. You got to go cover to cover. Okay. And let me just say this, because people have told me this, but I don't understand Leviticus. I don't understand them. I don't understand the book of Hebrews. You know what I tell them? Read it anyway. God grants you the understanding in time by his Spirit. Read it anyway. Why? Because the more of God in his word that you have in you, you see where I'm going here, the less you'll be subject to attack.
Amen. Amen.
Because you have the Spirit of God and his word in you.
Amen.
And it's like that repelling off. The more they come to hit you, the more they bounce off. The more they bounce off. Oh, there's a spirit-filled Christian. I want to touch it, but I can't. There's a man who prays to be filled with the Spirit every day. I want to give him, but I can't. There's a man who shakes the dust off his feet and believes what God says is what God means. I try to get to them, but I can't.
Amen.
You got to recognize that God wants us to stand.
Yes.
You don't have no business running for your life. You should better stand your ground, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You got to believe that, and you got to receive that, because it's real.
Yes.
The devil is deceitful. And I'm not telling you, you don't have emotional, we can have emotional problems, mental problems, of course we can. But we know how to get help for that, and we get help for that. We still don't give that over to the devil. And yes, this even goes along the lines of, you need to be careful where you get your advice. Whether it's personal advice or professional advice, you just can't go to everybody. Well, what's the big deal? I don't really believe it. I just want to go to a palm reader just to experience it. You know what happens when you play with fire. It will get you. You have to be careful. You have to be careful. One way to make sure you're successful in this world today and receive of all the grace and mercy that God has for you and I is to be fully suited up.
Yeah.
Let's look at what he tells us about the enemy. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Folks, this isn't a physical thing. If it's a physical thing, we could handle that in most cases. This is past physical. But against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in what? High places. Wherefore, take unto you again, there's those two words, whole armor, say it again, whole armor. That you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. God wants Christians to be able to stand in this world today.
Yeah.
But to stand and to withstand, he wants us to stand and withstand. So after the devil attacks you, we don't need to be all burnt out and weakened and everything else. We should be able to get up and keep going, because again, God is with us. But we got to learn to take him at his word. He wants us to withstand in the evil day. Folks, this is an evil day we're living in today. I don't know if you realize that or not. A lot of evil in our world today. We have seen things over the last year, 2, 3, 4 years, that, quite frankly, we might have thought about, but we never thought we'd see it to this level. There's a lot of evil going around in this world today. And the sad part for the child of God, which challenges your faith, this is why you got to be fully equipped. Some of that evil is coming from places, hear me clearly, that you think the teaching and preaching the word of God.
Yeah.
It's coming from places that you're like, but you got a cross in front of your building.
Yep.
You support missionaries. And then we hear some of the nonsense coming out of people's mouths. See, you never know where the attack's going to come from. But what you do know is going to come. And it hurts because we're bewildered, because we're like, wait a minute. I sat to eat with you. We fellowship together as churches. This doesn't make sense. It's not even about politics. It's just not according to the word of God. It's wrong. It's evil. And you say you're doing it in the name of the Lord? Where is that in scripture which is telling me to do? Explain it to me. Interpret that. Whatever version you want. Show me that that's correct what you're saying and doing. We have to understand that the evil day is upon us. But we got to stand, saints. God doesn't want us turning tail and running. He wants us to be properly equipped. He's given us salvation. He's given us his grace and mercy. Now he's telling us, you got to do the rest. I will be there with you, but I could bring you the armor like a soldier. When they go through their basic training, and then they get to whatever store they go to or whoever drops off their equipment, it only does them good when they put it on. Brother Jackie, I know you understand that. That to be an effective soldier, you got to wear the equipment. You can't say, well, you know, those boots ain't my style. I prefer a red helmet. You got to wear what they give you. Well, that breastplate is just not my, it's just not what I like. If you want to survive, you will put that equipment on. And see, this is the thing you gotta understand when you're putting on the whole armor of God. Sometimes you might not feel so comfortable. But you gotta put it on anyway. Because what it means is you about to take a stand. You about to engage in battle. And you're gonna need to be fully equipped. Fully equipped.
Amen.
Having done all, having done everything you could, God wants us to stand. There are times in ministry, and I know I'm not alone in thinking this, where you feel like you done just given it all that you could give, and I just can't get no more. And if this is the way you feel about it, or feel about me, or feel about the ministry, then I just go wherever, and I just go sit myself down. And what the Lord constantly reminds me is, you got to keep standing. Because the battle, it's for everybody who's a child of God. We're all going to be engaged. It's not a matter of whether you're going to be engaged. It's a matter of how you're going to respond. Because you're going to be in the battle. And so when people don't appreciate it, or don't say thank you, or don't act like they don't care, that's not what you're in the battle for to begin with. What I need you to do is to keep standing. Even when the enemy seems to be closer than the enemy ever was, keep standing. Even when I don't understand why people are thinking this way, keep standing. Even though when the enemy is just constantly throwing down arrows upon you, keep standing. Because again, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You can't forget that. You got to know your enemy. When I go see people at work, I generally will always get a little slight profile if I don't know them from the past, because I need to know who I'm dealing with when I'm walking into. Sometimes I might respond if I know the situation, give me a minute, and when they finish talking, I'll close my door and say a quick prayer. Lord, I don't know how this is going to go, but I need to be filled with your spirit and covered with your blood. And I need your power. Because I don't know what's going to happen when I sit down across the table. See, there are times when you don't see it coming. And it's there. But even in those times, you got to still stand. Because God is able to make you stand. You know, when you have a child who is hurting or being hurt, you're going to stand for that child as long as it takes. Amen. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I haven't been in the school system, but my kids were in school, okay? And they're telling you all kinds of lies about your child. Well, they're not this. Well, they're not that. Well, you know, I hold them back 2 years, not just 1 year. Well, maybe they need to go. And if a child needs special help, then we get that child special help. But what I'm not going to allow people to do, and what you should allow people to do, is dictate to you what's best for your child.
Amen.
Because you know your child. And there are times when people are pushing you at that level, and you got to stand and push back. And sometimes, I mean, you got to stand. You ever been in a meeting where you're sitting down and then you just stand up? Because it's like, maybe you're not hearing me clearly. This isn't going down like this. God wants us to stand and to be strong. You know, if we listen to every teacher, and not that they're all bad, because we know they're not, but everybody who told us what's wrong with our children, they'd have never been nothing. But praise God, I could confidently say, especially with this group and the group seeing us online, watching us online right now, God has blessed all of our children.
Amen.
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 Amen. He's blessed all of our children to do great things, and he will continue to bless them. But you got to understand, just like you stand for them, you got to stand for your faith, you got to stand for your salvation, you got to stand for what's right. Let's talk about the armor. Having your loins girded about with truth. See, the devil is a liar. Okay, do you understand that Satan likes to lie? Does everybody know that?
Yeah.
John tells us that he has been a liar from the beginning. He's the father of lies, okay? You got to hold on to the truth, okay? John 10 tells us that the thief coming up for the steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's what the thief is. That's the devil. He's a liar, okay? You got to recognize that he is the father of lies, okay? Let me look up the scripture real quick. Yes, John 8:44. Ye are of your father the devil, and this is you know, Jesus talking, and the lust of your father you will do. Now notice what he says about the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, didn't abide in the truth, because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a what? A liar and the father of it. You need to understand that the devil's a liar. So you got to know the truth. You've got to have yourself, your loins, you got to be surrounded in your vital purse with the truth. The Bible says in John 8, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. John 14, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You don't get to the Father but through me. You need to know the truth of God's word. So how can you know the truth? You got to read it daily and apply it to your life every day.
Amen.
You got to challenge me. You got to challenge others. If somebody says something from this pulpit that doesn't make sense, you got to go look in the word of God for yourself. You know, when I post notes for people to read and jot down and follow, when Pastor Thomas speaks, or like a Brother Jackie, or like a Deacon Davis, when they have notes, they're just not because we like to see ourselves right. You need to write them down and use those notes to further examine the Word of God. You've got to know the truth in this world today, saints. Think about how many lies are going on in this world today that have deceived millions of people. Just lies. You have got to understand that Satan is the father of lies, and that's all he does is lie. So if you aren't a child of God, and if you're not committed to God, then you just end up being a liar. But if you know the truth, That's not what God's word says. I know you're scared. You done had some personal issues in your life. You done lost loved ones. You done lost employment. You done lost your car. You done lost your great health. So you ain't got nothing going on. No, that's not the truth. The truth is, Jesus will never leave me nor forsake me.
Amen.
The truth is, God's going to supply all my needs. Amen. The truth is, even though I'm weak now, I'm going to be strong. The truth is, even though weeping may endure for a night, a week, a month, the truth is, I'm going to get my joy back because joy comes in the morning. The truth is, when he says, I'm never going to leave you nor forsake you, that's what he means. The truth is, when he says, I want you to be the head and not the tail, that's what he means.
Amen.
When he says, I want to bless you, that's the truth. So even though your life right now is not at the point where you want it to be, the truth is you are not alone. The truth is others have suffered afflictions just like you have. It's just yours is the newest. But other people have suffered great loss. Other people have had sick children. Other people have lost loved ones close to them. Other people have gone through family drama. You know, we go through family drama and we think, boy, my family's crazy. No, your family's like every other family. We got some drama. I'm happy to say and thankful I was raised in a solid Christian home with two Bible-believing, church-going parents, but that did not absolve us of drama. You got 10 folks in the house, children. You can have some drama. You can have some drama with one child in the house. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I like to tease young parents. I says that, you know, enjoy those special moments now when their babies and cute and they can't really talk back to you. And they look at you with a smile on their face. And I remember there was a lady at work who said, I can't wait till my baby starts talking. I said, yes, you can. Because once they start talking and standing and moving, and especially now, for whatever the reasons are, there are lots of reasons kids seem to be so further along in advance. Mm-hmm. When they start talking, you be shaking your head sometime. Where did that come from? Remember, and we all got stories like this. We're talking to a grandson, and he's telling me he had to give me his thesis for him thinking that way. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? Where are you getting this stuff from? What is your daddy doing that work? What, you listening to him on the phone or something? He's doing these business calls? And I'm thinking, I don't even know what that means. And he's not the only one. If you around young kids today and just listen to them talk, their words are a whole lot bigger than see, spot, run. Okay. Whole lot bigger. But guess what? We keep praying for them because we know the world that they're in now. It's a whole lot different. So you better make sure you know the truth and you better make sure that you impart the truth into them. Because once they leave the comfort of our home, the sanctity of that home, there's going to be lies coming at them left to right to left, and straight down the middle. You've got to make sure that in this battle that you have the truth. And the way you're going to know the truth, David said it this way, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. You've got to know the truth. When you get that app on your phone, that Bible app, when it gives you a pop-up verse, you need to read it. And you also need to just read your Bible and keep hold to the truth of God's word. Because there are a lot of lies going on in our world today. A lot of lies. The breastplate of righteousness. See, Satan wants to make you think that you're not good enough. We are righteous because he is righteous. You hear me there? Mm-hmm. We are made righteous because he is righteous. And we got to do our best to live the righteous life as God gives us the power and the truth and the strength to do it. People have got to know about you before you even get there. That's the frontal section. They've got to know when you are coming, there's a man of integrity, that there's a lady of integrity and truth. They've got to know that. Or do people think when they see you coming, sometime he's righteous and she's righteous and sometime they're not? Especially in the world today, we all got to check ourselves sometime, don't we? Because sometimes people say things to us or concerning us or something that just is totally off the wall. And the righteous answer isn't what we're thinking about giving people sometimes. But the Lord wants us to put on that breastplate of righteousness. So people could see, no, they're for real, even in the midst of their pain or their suffering. Satan will always attack those who are living righteously for the Lord. Because again, he can affect their salvation, their eternal security. But if you get people to think Montgomery Baptist is a bunch of phonies, their pastors are no good, their leaders are no good, their members are no good, then he wins a great victory. We've got to make sure that our righteousness goes ahead of us. And that we do all we can to do by staying prayed up, surrounded with the truth, to live a righteous life through the one who gives us strength. We've got to walk around with peace, and that's hard to do today, having your feet sharp with the preparation of the gospel of peace. See, people want to make us think sometime, well, Satan's going to make you think sometime, well, it's not really working. I can't, the gospel is just not having an effect on people. People aren't coming to Christ like they used to. People aren't coming to church like they used to. Well, all those may be true at different points in times. It's still the gospel that saved. Jesus Christ was crucified, buried, and rose again and died for our sins. Amen. Just because you don't see all the results you want to see, don't let Satan trick you into saying, I'm going to stop sharing the gospel. Amen. And yes, the gospel does bring us peace. Amen. When I have gone through, my experiences with the major health issues, the one thing that kept me just going was the gospel of peace, the gospel that he said, you're my child. Amen. No matter what happens, you're still going to be my child. Whether I take you home or let you stick around, you're still going to be my child. See, there comes a point in your Christian life where you got to have the peace, as Paul says over Philippians, that goes beyond our human understanding. Amen. That no matter what you're going through, I believe the word of God. I believe the gospel. It is truth. And I'm going to share it every chance I get. Mm-hmm. Because it's blessed me, it's saved me, it's helped my family, and it's that same gospel that's saving people today. Yeah, I know we have COVID-19 and hopefully coming to an end, but for the last year it's been difficult to go places and evangelize and do certain things. But the fact of the matter is, COVID or no COVID, the gospel hasn't changed. Amen. And we still have to be a witness. Whether you are a mega church or a smaller church like this one, the gospel is still the gospel. And when our feet move, we need to be sharing the gospel when we get an opportunity to share the gospel. Doesn't mean you got to preach to people. It just means you got to share the gospel. You know, think about it this way. I realized this many, many years ago. People come to you and me for a reason. They're not just coming because they like your outfit or they like your hair. That might be something to get them into the conversation with you, but they're coming because there's something about you. Think about that. Something about your personality, about your spirit, about your attitude. So when they come to you, don't miss the opportunity to share the gospel of peace. Let me tell you something. If you've never had the blessing, the privilege of bringing somebody to the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, I can't explain how great that feels.
Yes.
See, we don't need to just keep hearing it from somebody else. We need to have that testimony ourselves. Daniel said it this way, he that winneth souls is wise. What a privilege it is to lead a family member, a child, a co-worker, a neighbor to this gospel of peace. But above all else, taking the shield of faith. The Bible says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. He that comes to God must what? Believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder of those who diligently, carefully seek him. Why do you need to show the faith? Because Satan's going to be thrown. See, Satan's not coming after you with big old spears. He just needs a little crease. It's like throwing that dart on a dartboard. Even if you don't hit the bullseye, the dart still will stick someplace. Satan don't got to go after your heart. He just needs to get in your mind, get in your thoughts, get in your head. You need to understand that you got to have faith in this world today. There's not a child of God, if we're being honest with each other, whose faith hasn't been tested over the last year. God, is this real? Are we really experiencing this? Are we really going through this? Did I just hear what I thought I heard? Did I just see masses of people going to the United States Capitol and then have it described as just a mild uprising? Did I hear that? Did I see officers not only be killed but die as a result? Did I just watch a news account of dozens of officers who now have emotional disorders who will never ever be the same on this side of heaven because of what they had to experience that day? Did I just hear somebody say, why are we making such a big thing out of that? What's the big deal? They were just a few people going on a tour. You hear this stuff. And people believe it. And you wonder, Lord, what is going on? But you gotta have the faith that even though what I'm seeing is wrong, even though what I'm seeing is just beyond the pale, Lord, I got faith that you're gonna keep me. I got faith that you're gonna protect my family. I got faith that as I do the basics, you will continue to grant me what I need every day, which is an extended portion of your grace and mercy. I got faith that even though I feel alone, it doesn't mean you left me. I got faith that even though this world is in a chaotic state right now, ultimately you're still in control.
Yes.
And I just got to keep in the battle. Yes. You know, I've said this for years. A lot of people say they love their jobs, and that's a good thing. You want to like your job, amen?
Amen.
It helps if you like it. But quite frankly, in many cases, people go to work just for the paycheck. In other words, if you could get whatever your salary is by staying home every day, come on, let's be real. Just put it in the bank, and we'll talk with you later. Generally, you work because you have to. Because you want a certain lifestyle. Because you want everybody to do what you want to do. But then sometimes it doesn't always work out. And you can have faith that God's going to continue to provide your need. You've heard my story, my wife, my family story. When we came down here, this was a whole new world for us. The expense compared to where we were at, it wasn't even in the same ballpark. And I can remember coming down here prior to my family coming down for about like a 2 months, I believe it was, and trying to get the lay of the land and traveling back and forth down the road and finally got to the place where we got to look for a home. We got to find a home. Staying with somebody in the ministry, but we got to find our own home. And the mortgages that I saw, even back in the early 2000s, compared to what we were paying, Lord, you got to make this happen, because I ain't got that kind of. You know, people say there's short money and long money, and there's also no money. Okay. You're telling me, Lord, I'm doing your work, and I'm going to go from paying the mortgage on the two-story house with a basement and an attic and a yard and a fenced-in yard and a porch. I remember my mortgage. I will never forget that mortgage. $364 a month. And probably 17 cents. To coming down here to lease for a couple years, and I got a deal, because basically what the guy did was take money off the first year, add it to the second year, because he assumed I'd make more money, to pay $950 a month to jump up by another $150 or $100 the next year. And by the way, we don't own that. So everybody said, man, you gotta buy a house. You gotta buy a house. You can't just keep paying rent. You gotta buy your own house. Yeah. I hear you. But you know what kept us going? Real simple. Faith. God, you didn't bring me down here to bust me up. Okay. I can't bring my kids and my wife and family down here and have nothing to give them. And the rest is history. Lord, I'm not coming down here. I didn't pass the churches before. I didn't mind it. It was great. But I'm just coming to do my little corner of the work in the Lord's kingdom. As most of you here knew of Pastor Hamilton, and we worked together well, and I remember him calling me up one day and saying, I made it clear, I'm just coming down to teach Sunday school. Maybe do a little praise and worship leadership, which I did early on. But this is your gig, not mine. How would you like to be a pastor at the church? We don't mind you doing the other ministry. You could just, that's not what I came down here for. But that's not what I asked you. And he was very persistent. And God just worked it all out. Why did he work it out? Because I had to keep the faith. So you got to learn, no matter what you're going through, and it gets hard sometimes. I say things that worked out. I probably wouldn't say, yeah, not bad things. I don't want you to think that. But just more direct things. That life begins with an S and ends with an S sometimes. It just is no good. But then what? Do you have the faith that you're going to survive this? Do you got faith that you're going to get through this? Because, yeah, I'm not in your shoes. I'm not facing 5 years. I didn't just lose my family. But you just did all these Bible classes and told me you're a believer. So, you got faith that God's going to restore what the locust has eaten? See, sometimes, folks, you're just left with your faith. Pastor, I'm in pain right now. Do you got faith that God knows that? And that God's going to get you through the pain? See, he doesn't say that we're not going to have pain. So many people want to teach you, oh, you become a child of God, everything's good, no pain. No, you're going to have some pain. Let me put it this way. I don't care if you're saved or not. You stub your toe in the middle of the night. Yeah. You might not shout like a good Christian, but you're going to shout. Okay? You can have some pain, but have faith so you can quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Then the last piece of equipment he tells us about is the helmet of salvation. Why the helmet? Protects your head, because I want to tell you, Saint, Satan attacks your mind. And through the midst of all these battles that we all have gone through, which you better be sure of is your salvation. Amen. You better be sure of whose you are. You better have the sword of the Spirit, as we already talked about, which is the Word of God, the truth. But you better make sure who's your daddy. You better make sure that he's your father. Because Satan is going to go after your mind. Because if he gets your mind to wander, what's that old hymn? Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. He goes after our mind. And he starts putting things in our visual sight line that we normally wouldn't even observe, but now we gave it a second look or a third look. He starts putting thoughts in our mind. Well, Maybe I could wait for God to bless me, or maybe I could go spend $50 and since the numbers are 370 million now, or whatever it is, maybe just $100, who knows? He plays with your mind. You need to know of your salvation. Because if you're not saved or not sure of your salvation, then those darts can be hitting their mark. And then you won't be any good. At the end of the day, saints, understand you're in the battle. And you have to suit up. Do you get tired of wearing the armor sometimes? I'm sure you do. Do I get tired of hearing people tell me, and don't forget, as if I'm ever going to forget, you're a Christian. You're the pastor. You're the chaplain. So you can't, don't even say it. Don't even think it. You can't get upset, although that's not true. The Bible doesn't tell us that. But people will tell you that and think that. And you done danced this dance for many years, many times, many days, and your faith is being tested. In the midst of it all, as you're suited up, as you're going through the storms of life and you're in battle, and believe me, whether you know it or not, you are engaged in a battle right now. Ask God for a double portion of his grace and mercy. Let him know that the armor, Lord, it feels a little heavy, but I got to keep wearing it because I want to survive. His grace and mercy has brought you through. And his grace and mercy, as we wear the whole armor of God, will continue to bring you through. He's been so loving. He's been so kind. He's been so persistent in his faithfulness to you and I in these difficult days that we've gone through personally and as a society. But don't forget that God is bringing you through something for a reason. He's bringing you through something this season to make you a stronger soldier, to make you more equipped for the battle, so that when it's all said and done, you can stand on your feet and say, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. My God is above all gods, because he is keeping me. You don't know what I've been through. I don't know what you've been through. But I know great is his mercy. Great is his mercy. Stand to your feet. If you recognize, if you can stand here at home and in person and recognize that your life has been a struggle at times, and that you took some shots at times, and your faith was tested at times, but you recognize, I had to get up in the morning just like I get dressed and suit up. I had to pray for God's spirit to control me. I had to pray that my faith would increase. As the disciples said, Lord, increase my faith. I had to assure myself that my salvation is real, that God has never left me nor forsaken me. He's taken me through the storms of life. I'm about to go into another storm. I don't want to go into it, but he's going to keep me, and I'm going to wear his armor until the day he calls me home and says, welcome into my presence. You ought to thank God for his spirit of mercy. You ought to thank God for his spirit of grace. You ought to thank God that you are living right now, that you're able to stand, that you can be raised up this morning, raised up and holding in your right mind. You don't know what somebody else is going through right now, but you can believe this, that we're all going through something. And life isn't easy. Life is painful sometimes. But I'm here to encourage you, just suit up. Just suit up. And don't give up. Don't give out. Don't give in. Because God still has, just like you might want to go out to get a tender steak, God has tender mercies. Tender mercies! Tender mercies! Tender mercies! So suit up, saints. It's not always comfortable. It doesn't feel good to have to be in the battle. We all want to break from the battle, but suit up, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Know this before Pastor Thomas comes, that God loves you. He has not forsaken you. You are not alone. He just wants you to look to him, tell him you love him, and he will tell you and show you that he loves you and he will keep you. Life isn't about being fair, because it's not going to be fair. For people, for ourselves, I can't explain the things I see happening. Why we got to answer question after question? Why we got to prove things over and over again? Why we got to be concerned about our children? But nevertheless, great is his mercy. So in the battle that you're in, don't give up. Don't give up. Because God's never going to leave you nor forsake you. Just say to yourself right now, Pastor Thomas, you can make your way up. Say to yourself, God loves me. Say it again. 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 God loves me. And believe that and receive that, because God loves you.
Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord. Thank the Lord for your trials and your tribulations. Many of us don't thank the God for our Lord for our trials and our tribulation. As Pastor was preaching, just thinking about being in school. And when you go to school, you're taught many things. And then after being taught, there comes a test. And you have to pass the test, because if you don't pass the test, you go through it again. Many times, that not only are there organized, scheduled tests, sometimes there's a pop quiz. Life with Jesus is the same way. Wow. We come into this world and we take on Christ as our personal Savior, and that Bible teaches us how to lean, trust, and depend on God. As he said, put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand. But every now and then in this Christian walk, in this Christian journey, there comes a test that we all must pass. Because if we don't pass it, sometimes there's a pop quiz and things happen in our life that we don't understand. Why me? And if you have not been through it, you're going to go through it one day in your life. And you're going to stand and you're going to ask, why me, Lord? Why did you take my loved one? Why did you take my job? Why did you put this sickness on me? Sometimes we just got to say in the midst of it all, Lord, thank you that you chose me to go through this trial and to go through this tribulation. Because if the devil don't test you, that means he already has you. Amen. Look at somebody and tell them, if the devil don't test you, is because he already has you. And we need to trust that God has brought us to it, and he's going to bring you through it. Yeah. Let's give the Lord a hand. Thank you, Lord, for all he has done and all he will do. As we make ready to close, we want to pray for the pastor and the first lady as they journey today.
Amen.
Amen. As he was talking earlier, I don't know about you, but I'm an organized traveler as well. when my family and I are traveling, whether we're traveling by plane or car, we have organized stops. We're not stopping before we get to that place that I said we're going to stop. And we're not going to stop again to the second stop. And if we only have two stops planned, that's all we're going to do. And if somebody got to go to the bathroom, I trust you better hold it. Because there's no other planned stops but these two. And we're going to stop when we say we're going to stop. Along the way. We're not going to stop before then. We're not going to stop after that, amen? We just recently, at the last minute, took a trip, and my wife we're counting the days we're going to be there, and she had like 7 outfits for 4 days. I said, "Man, where are you going with all these clothes?" She said, "Cause I just want to just put on what I want to put on." I said, "No, Monday you're going to wear this, Tuesday, and Thursday we're going to wear this. All that other stuff got to stay there." Amen. But we thank God for Jesus and all that he has done. Let's make ready to pray and then close out and pray for our pastor as they journey today. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you. We praise you, Lord. We thank you for all that you have done. We thank you for all we have seen, Lord. We thank you for all we have heard. And most of all, Lord, we thank you for what our spirit have felt. Father God, we ask right now if you would continue to look upon our pastor, look upon our first lady. Give them traveling grace, Father God. Let your angels go before them and open up the ways, Lord, for them, that their journey would be safe, Father God. Anoint the roadway, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Anoint the steering wheel, Father God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you right now for your power. We thank you for your glory. We thank you for your majesty, Lord. We thank you for the people under the sound of my weak voice that have come out to witness this occasion on today. Father God, someone among us needs you right now. Someone among us right now, Lord, don't understand. Someone among us right now is going through something, Father God, and don't even understand why they have been chosen for this time, why they have been chosen for this moment, why they have been chosen for this second. Lord, but I thank you right now because you're going to do something greater on the other side. Father God, we praise you right now as we go through this journey. Father God, we praise you for your power as we go through it. Father God, we praise you for the victory.
Yes.
Because you did not bring us thus far to lose us. Look upon this church, Lord. Look upon the membership, Lord. Bless us financially. Bless us spiritually. Bless us socially. Bless us in number, Lord. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Father God, as we close out this portion of our service, we ask that you would continue to be with us until we make it to this place again. Bless those that have tuned in. Father God, it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Until next Sunday, God bless you. And I'll turn over to you.